And good morning, everybody, and welcome to another master class. This time, developing .NET tools in MacScript. I assume on your screen you can see the outline for what we're going to try and cover today. So I'm going to start off by showing you the final tool, what we're going to actually try and develop in class, and obviously discuss how it's being developed. I'm going to have to skip some things and jump over stuff quickly in some areas to try and fit everything in. In the 3 hours, but essentially, we should be able to cover most of the concepts at least and get an understanding of where we're going. So, what it is and how it's used, objects and classes and how to inspect them and how to know how to use them. And I'll show you the tutorials if you haven't already found them on Penn Productions. I'm going to show you around the tool, and then we're going to get into creating different forms. Which I assume some of you have already done. Is there anybody here who has not touched .NET at all, who has no .NET experience? Just give me a heads up. And XML and utilizing it. So just the one person has not touched .NET at all. Cool. All right. Well, this should be easy then. XML. How about XML? Anybody in here not used XML? XML files and whatnot, and reading them. And we're going to get into custom attributes, just creating those quickly, callbacks, and we're going to try and tie it all together, obviously, and make a tool work and make it all come together. So we are going to jump in and show you what we're going to create today. So what I have is a fabulous obligatory teapot that we always like to abuse in Macs. Everybody can see that, I'm sure. And also, can you confirm I'm orbiting the teapot slowly right now? Are you getting a reasonable feedback rate? It won't be perfectly smooth, but so everybody's good? Sort of okay, smooth here. Again, it's going to depend on your speed on your end, but this will never be perfect. Because it's coming to you in real time. Okay, so if you have any questions or anything during the class, just fire them up there. If I don't answer, well, that's because I don't have the time to go through all of them. So what I have is a teapot, and I have the tool that we're going to write. So here's our joystick tool. I don't know if you guys have taken a look at the joystick light tool that I'm developing on my website, essentially, it was built right after doing the first masterclass on this tool here. And this is a really simple tool. It'll basically search the entire scene and find all the attribute holders currently in the scene that have a certain custom attribute definition on them that holds information about tracks of data and XML data as well in it. And what it does is allows us to be able to tie together tracks of animation with a joystick control and be able to pick out of that control and use the one control for multiple inputs essentially. So what I've done, and if we take a look at the teapot, you'll see that we have an attribute holder with a joystick container custom attribute definition on it. And in there we have four tracks of animation. And essentially all I've done is wired the position tracks and the rotation tracks up to these four tracks that I have on the attribute holder. Okay, so it's pretty straightforward there. So all we have to do is drive these tracks. Now I've done it this way so that essentially any track could be wired to it. It doesn't need to drive position and rotation. It could be anything. It could be morph targets. It could be bones. It could be rotations of things. Whatever you want, doesn't matter. It could be an opacity map. Anything could be driven by it instead of being very, very specific. The tool then essentially is a .NET label, and it's tracking your mouse, and it's drawing a dot where your mouse is, and using GDI plus drawing. So we're going to have to work with some GDI drawing. It has a bitmap in the background to make it look cool. We've got two list views. So some of you said you've already worked with list views. So I'm just using two simple list views to get started. And essentially, it just allows for a really quick and fast access to things. Now, I should be able to, if I actually duplicated this and rerun my script, because there's no update on this one currently, it'll actually list both attribute holders, and if I change the name of them, it'll actually list the name differently. And what you'll notice is that I can actually move them separately now and move them around. So it's automatically finding the amount of them in the scene and going and just manipulating that object. Okay, great, Laurent, fantastic. Let me just check and see your status here. Everything looks good. Okay, so we were just discussing how the tool works there and how it goes. So it's pretty straightforward as to how the end user is going to use it. So let's start taking a look at writing this and developing it. Don't want that up. I'll minimize that. Sorry, give me one second here. And so let's start taking a look at developing tools and how they're built and how we're going to use them. Now, .NET has got a whole lot of information online on the MSDN library, and there's a link to this off of my .NET page. And so in my website under tutorials, .NET and Mac script, you'll get to this page, and there's the link to the library here, as well as some overview of how to do some of these things that we're going to be discussing today. But I'm going to show you how to sort of tie it all together then into a complete tool. The MSDN library can be a little overwhelming at first. If you go into .NET development, framework, whatever framework we're going to work with, I'll just click on 4 because it's where I was last. Where is it? Class library. And the class library will give you all the classes of objects that can be created. And there is quite a number of them, and certainly when it comes down to the forms, the windows and whatnot. So when you look at system windows, forms, essentially this is a listing of all the system windows, and then system windows forms gets really, really large in how many possibilities can be created. So you can tell right off the bat that .NET is a whole lot more flexible than what we can just do in native Mac script. Certainly it gives us a lot of flexibility to be able to control whatever we need. So let's start looking at actually building our tool here and understanding how it works. Let me just zoom this in so we can see it a bit better. And what we're going to start with is creating just a simple UI to get started. And then we're going to start populating that with .NET controls and showing you how to inspect them and work with them. Now, this simple tool that I wrote actually is just sort of as a note, it's actually just in a standard create dialog with .NET tools and everything built into it. So it's one of the things I'm going to show is you don't necessarily have to use a .NET form to actually handle this stuff. You can go ahead and use a MacScript form. Now, one of the reasons I do that sometimes is sometimes I want to actually attach other things that are MacScript to the rollout to make it easy because it can often be a lot less code working in MacScript UI stuff than it is to work in .NET UI stuff. So I'll tend to use create dialog instead of a .NET forms, because as soon as you do that, you're really quite stuck to .NET at that point. And if you've got to do something quick and simple, it might be a little bit more difficult than you need. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off with a struct-based tool. Now, how many people here use structs? For their tool development. Once, love them. Nope. Okay, so if you're not, I suggest you start. It's a great way to sort of wrap a container around your tools and make sure that everything is local and you're not having global variables floating around. Essentially, the tool that I've just developed, this is a structure normally used for obviously creating structures of data. So you might do something like my character, name, comma, H-E-I-G-H-T, height, you know, weight, this sort of thing. And this becomes named data that you can actually go and access through my character. Now, you can also use it for tools development, so you can start building tools inside it here. So what we're going to do is we're going to build a function right off the bat that's going to be called UI. And this UI is going to contain a rollout, I'll just call it something simple. And what we'll do is we'll also create a run function. Now, everything inside of a struct needs to be separated by a comma, just like an array. So we need a comma in there to make sure that it's you're going to run correctly. And I usually do a run function as well. And this run function will check to see if our UI exists. So what I'm going to do is create an instance for our UI as just a variable at the top and call it undefined. So far I've got a variable called UI instance, local to the struct. I have a rollout. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to check to see if this UI instance and is if it's undefined, and if indeed it is undefined, I'm going to go ahead and run it basically and run the code. So we'll just go and do UI, and I'll do create dialog UIR. And what we'll also do is when we create that dialog, I'll set and make sure that the UI instance is actually set to be the UI itself. And if not, I'll destroy the rollout that we've held in UI instance and set it back to undefined. Let me just save that to something. So does everybody follow that then? Here's our total tool so far. Basically, it's a structure. Inside it, we're holding each element. In this case, we've got some variables at top. We have two functions. And the first function called UI is creating a rollout. And it's, so if we actually run this entirely, it's going to completely create a rollout. Tiny little one that is. And the run function is going to check and see if the UI instance is undefined, create the rollout, which then creates it and sets the UI instance to be defined. And if not, if it is defined, then go ahead and destroy it. So what's nice now is we can actually we have to create an instance at the bottom of our structure, take the instance of it, .run, and when we run it, it should actually open up the dialog. You run it again, it'll close the dialog. So it's actually nice because what it generates is an open-close tool. And what we'll do is then create a macro script that will just simply run the jstool.run, and it will act as a toggle to toggle it open and closed. Everybody follow that so far? Matt, you said nope to something. Was that new or old? Old, okay. All right. So that's fine for everybody so far, right? So let's give this a width of, 500. Let's see what I did over here. Sorry, I've got the other one on the other side here. Yeah. Exactly what it was. And height of 300 for the rollout. Now let's start actually creating some .NET controls and whatnot. Now, the way we create .NET controls is pretty simple. start off with the keyword .NET object. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to do this in just a new script here because it might be better being color-coded. So I'm going to start off by creating some .NET object. And I'll start off in the pure .NET way here to be able to create this. So if you're creating .NET objects on their own, and this is the way that we do it, we say .NET object, and then we have to basically give the path inside of a string. So system.windows.forms, and if we go back to our class library, you can see that what we've got here is system.windows.forms. And essentially, System Windows Forms then has all of the different forms that are possible to be able to use. So there's a combo box. So system.windows.forms.combobox will get us, a given .NET object form. Now, what we're actually going to be using to start off with is going to be called a split container. And the split container is ability to be able to split our tool into two. So let me just pull this back up and have it up here for reference. So what I have to start with inside of my create dialog is a large container that sits right in there. That's basically the same size as the create dialog. And it's a split container, so it splits it into two. So it allows me to be able to split it into a left and a right side, or a top and a bottom. Now, if I run this, you'll see it returns back a split container for us. And what we can do is we can inspect this. I'm just going to create a variable there. And we can check and see what kind of variables and events and methods that are held inside this. And so we can use the show properties on SC to actually, and here, let me just clear this and run it again. And so as far as properties go, all of this is then properties to the split container and how it can be set up. So again, if you haven't used .NET and you've used only Mac script, you can see that there are a whole lot more properties to be had. We can also go and use show methods, and methods are the functions. And you can see there's a whole lot of methods. Okay, so an enormous amount of methods that can be accessed. And show events. And there's a whole lot of events. So these are all the event handlers for when you were checking whether or not key up or key down and whatnot. But there are a lot of them. So as you start looking through these, you'll find that there's a lot of cool things that you can do with them when you start playing around with it all. Now, what I have to make my life easy is I've written a function here, and I'll just go ahead and copy paste that into our script right at the top. So you can see it. And I'll just give it a header so that we know what we've got here. I don't know how many people actually use the abbreviations files. Anybody actually use these? Because I can't live without them anymore, as well as the autocomplete and whatnot. So if you're not using abbreviations, you should get these set up. Essentially, you can set up just strings of, with a header equals, function header equals, and then you set up what's going to actually get replaced when you type in the word header and hit a hotkey. So if I type in the word function and go Control-Shift-A, it turns it into an entire function statement for me with the header above it and everything else. So if you're not using those, you should. It speeds things up a lot. The other thing you'll notice is whenever I type, it does an item here that's last used. I just need to hit Enter. And if you're not using that, that is found under the user options. And there's the user options, buffer, tab bar. What else do I have set here? Ignore case and whatnot. And autocomplete automatic equals one. And that'll autocomplete. Speeds up your workflow a whole lot. So that's another one that you should have a look at if you're not using it all the time. So what this function does that we just generated is it's going to do it all for us. I'm going to use format props so that I can get access to this really quickly and easily and be able to inspect everything. So it has several here that it's using. And one of the things it does is that it also pumps out show constructors. So .NET is a command in MacScript, and it has a lot of properties to it. So it's a structure basically that has properties. Show constructors will basically show you how to construct it if you've got a class or whatever. So you'll also want that one because it'll be handy. So this is going to format it nice and clean out to the listener each time. And so if I actually just run that, I'm going to run it just on its own out of our tool here. And if I go back to my show props SC and run that, you can see it's just formatted a whole lot of stuff to my listener. And this is all of the, so there's the constructors up top, how to create it, system windows form split container, which we already know because we've done it. All of the properties, all of the methods, all of the events that are available to us. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a split container, but now we're going to do the split container directly inside of a rollout. And because we're directly inside of a MacScript rollout right now, we have to do it a little bit differently than the method that we actually used here. So we're going to have to use that, a MacScript way of creating it that's going to allow us to be able to build it directly inside of it. So it's not unlike doing the rest of our UI items, except we're going to use .NET control. And .NET control is specific to MacScript, essentially, and it's going to create a .NET control inside of a MacScript rollout for us. If we did the other method, we wouldn't be able to do it, or at least not easily anyways. There's a huge hack workaround to make it work, but it wouldn't work. This is the easiest way. So .NET control, we give the internal name just like we would anything when we're creating a UI item in MacScript. So we'll call it type properly would be good while I speak. And then what we need is that path that basically gives us the .NET container. So system windows forms split container. So there's our container created. Now the next thing we want to do is we're actually going to add some immediate variables to it, just like we can with standard MacScript, width, height, and an offset value and whatnot, so that we can actually build it in. So I happen to know, because I've got the script beside me, that these values should actually get us a nice .NET container built into it. So if I run this now, unknown property width somewhere, where did that suddenly come in? I've done... joystick control. One second here, guys. I have an error coming up, and I'm not... My joystick control R. Oh, is the rollout. Yeah, dummy. Trying to figure out where it comes from. I'm going to have to... you know what I'm going to do to make my life easy? I'm going to change the name of my rollout so when I cut and paste, I don't lose my mind. How's that? There we go. We're going to call it joystick control R now for my rollout name, all right? I should be able to run that now. So instead of just seeing create dialog with the black or the gray background that you normally would, what you're seeing now is the split container been offset a little bit, just bumped it over and bumped it down so it fits in there with a little bit of a space around it. So there's my split container. Now once you have a .NET control, unlike MacScript where it immediately gives you a UI item and whatnot, we're going to actually have to initialize this and start it up so that it actually, it has properties set so that we know how it's going to look and how it's going to work. What we're going to do is we're just going to run a little command in our rollout as soon as it opens. And we're going to call it init splitcon. So init splitcon is going to be a function that we're going to add. Oops. And it is going to go and generate our split container for us. Now what we're going to do is we're going to store a variable for our split container. I think that's what I do anyways. No, I don't. Sorry, I'm just checking what I've done on the other side so I don't make mistakes. I went through it again the other night to make sure that it's all clear as to what I did so that I don't have to think as much, if that's okay with you guys, while I try and explain it. So what we're going to do is we're going to call the function, send it split container, and sender, for those of you who have not done .NET, tends to be used a whole lot. It is the item that is being sent, so it is the .NET control, the form item that is being called on. So you'll see that used a lot. We'll just give that an equals. And what we'll do is we'll set up the init split container now with what we need to do. And I'm just going to cut and paste a big chunk of this. So if we check the properties of the system Windows form split container, you'll find that it has several of them. Back color will give us the color. Orientation will tell us which way the actual orientation of the split container should work. Splitter distance, so basically how far over is that center line, the width of it, you know, that gives us the thickness to it, and is it fixed? Can somebody actually grab and move it? Now, if the color, if you notice right now, I'm running this odd line here, dn color, and what dn color is a little function I've written up at the top of my code, and I'm going to cut and paste that now. And let's just drop that in below here. And dn color basically is a little function I've written that creates a .NET class. So let's start taking a look at this. So if I grab this .NET class, and I run it, so a .NET class will create as a class. And in this case, to get a color, you run a .NET class. And let me just zoom this up so you can see what it's returning. And when you inspect its properties, you'll notice that what we can do is we can actually, once we have the class, we can actually create colors. Now, you can't just pass things as in all cases as MacScript values. So in MacScript, you'd pass it a color value, or you'd pass it a 0.3 value if you need to color it at any point in time. But this is .NET. We have to pass things as objects, and we have to generate objects and pass those objects around. So this is going to be an object that holds a color value for the .NET split container. So in doing that, we can find out that if we do .aqua, for instance, actually, let's just do that will return to us. And let's just clear this again. That'll return to us a color object. So you can see now it says .NET object, sift and drawing color. What we've done is we've returned a color with the color aqua in it. And so what I've done is I'll used another method. So there is a method in here from ARGB. And from ARGB basically states that if we pass it in RGB or ARGB value, we can actually get it to build the color for us. Now you can do it, and if you notice, there's multiple ways here, and this is something you always want to check on when you look at the methods for any of the objects and classes. In this case, we can say from ARGB and just pass it int32 value for each. We can also break it into an alpha value and another color value. We can also break it down into just R, G, and B. And if you set in just R, G, and B, it'll ignore the alpha if you don't pass the four values. If you pass all four values, you'll have alpha first, then R, G, and B. So it's interesting. There's multiple different ways of actually building them and making the controls that we need to get it to work. So in this case, we're going to say from ARGB, we can give it an alpha value, and the rest, and what we get out of that is we get our .NET color back. Okay? Does that make sense to everyone? So what I have is I've written a function to make my life a little bit easier so that I'm not having to write out the .NET class system drawing color over and over again. And what I'm doing is I'm passing that function just a 0.3 value because it's nice and simple and understandable, and an alpha value to it. And essentially this will create a black by default, and I can pass it the values. So right off the bat, what I'm saying is center.color, call my color function, pass in the colors. Now max back color, I don't know if you guys are aware of this, undefined, and I think I defined that. There it is right here. Is a little variable I've generated using colorman. So this is a command in MaxScript. Colorman background will actually return to you a normalized color value, so 0 to 1 color value for the background of Max. So if you look up the colorman tools in MaxScript, you can get all the different colors that are being used for the UI. This way your UI can match the Max UI, because again, MaxScript will automatically do it, but .NET won't. It will let you color it however you want to color it. So we're going to have to generate them. Now what I've done is generated the normalized value here, and I have to multiply it by 255. Might have been easier just to do it here once and get it as a 255 color value as opposed to a normalized color value. And then an alpha. The orientation, again, if we run that... And to explain this one, dot orientation, where are we here? There we are, dot orientation. So this is one that starts confusing people and how to actually use it. We're going to run into it all the time. If we take a look at the properties of our split container, you'll notice that we'll see things like height, system int 32. In .NET, you can go and create a system int 32 object that holds an integer value, basically. There's one of our colors. So there's our for color. That'd be our text colors and whatnot. And it's a system drawing color. So that's needing an object. They're all basically needing objects. Now in MaxScript will do some conversions for us automatically. So there's some built-in ones. If we pass a height value, we don't actually have to build the system int 32 object. MaxScript will automatically convert it for us and see it. In other cases, it simply won't understand to do that. Boolean values, for instance, are converted as well. But if we go down to orientation here, there's no direct correlation for this. What you're seeing is Windows System Forms is an actual object that needs to be placed into that orientation channel. So we actually have to make an object that tells it what the orientation is. Now what's nice is, instead of having to build this object this way, what we can do is we can say c.orientation and run it. And what you'll actually notice is Windows System Forms split container, so sc.orientation actually returns to us one of those objects. So it is a .NET object. It makes sense, because if you're using the height of an object, or the x height of an object, or a position of an object, sorry, it's a float value, so you have to pass it a float value. You could easily say the x position equals x position of another object. They're both float objects. So same holds true in .NET. The actual orientation is indeed the object. So if we actually inspect sc.orientation, it itself has properties, methods, and possibly even events. So in this case, it has properties and more methods. So you can actually run more methods and properties from the orientation. In this case, what we can find is that there's actually horizontal and vertical properties. So dot vertical, and I'll just highlight just this one section and run it, sends us the orientation we need. So it sends us the orientation object we need to actually tell it to be vertical. So you'll notice that when I actually set the value of sender.orientation, I simply say sender.orientation equals sender.orientation.vertical. So I don't have to go through the process of building a .NET object to get that vertical orientation. I could, But this is the easier way. Just center.orientation and then go and get the object that's stored right in itself and set it back onto the orientation. Does that make sense? Because we're going to be doing this a fair bit. Yep, okay. Now, the next thing is real simple, obviously. You can see that splitter distance, splitter width, is splitter fixed. They're just max script values. They're being converted on the fly. So I should be able to run this without error. And of course, I get an error right away. Oops, open do. See, this is the problem with trying to teach coding and talk at the same time. You constantly miss little things. Not that I don't miss little things all the time anyways, but it's difficult to teach this sort of stuff inside of 3 hours. So if you see me make a mistake, guys, speak up quickly, please, because I've probably missed it, all right? So now you can see that it's grayed into the background and that it actually has values that are the same as the max script dialog. We can't see the splitter anymore. It's in here somewhere. It's 200 units over. But if you want, and you want to actually check this sort of thing out, what we can do is we can work with different colors on different sides. So I'm going to go format on the SC again here. Oops. And it is, where it is, splitter distance. I have to remember what this is. Panel 1 and panel 2. So to get access to the two sides of it, there's panel 1 and panel 2. And again, what I can check is dot panel 1, and you'll notice it has all its own events, all its own methods, and of course, all its own properties. And again, one of the things it has is a back color. So we could actually check, and just for sake of argument, we could actually go and say sender.panel1.backcolor equals, and set some different color here just to see what we're going to get. So let's go and actually just add, just for the sake of argument, and panel 1, whoops, dot. So there's the back color on the right of the panel changed to red. I often do this when I'm coding .NET just to see where things are to start with and so that I actually know what I'm working with. So there's the back color. We can comment that out later so that we can see one side. Okay, so let's continue on with the rest of the tool then and start building it. Now that we have the actual split container in there, what we can start doing now is writing sort of proper MaxScript.net and building all of our controls as .NET objects as opposed to .NET controls. Again, the .NET control will build it directly into the MaxScript rollout UI. Well, what I've done is I've built a container now that I can stick all of my .NET stuff into, and it's a lot more robust when you do it this way. When you start working with just the .NET stuff. So there's the split container done. And what I'm going to do next is run a couple other lines. I'm going to run an init left panel. So let's initialize the left panel of the split container. And let me just find that in my other piece of code. And I will cut and paste that and then explain it all. So this looks like a big function right now, but it's not so bad. You're going to find out what we're going to be doing. Init left panel basically goes through and builds a flow layout panel. Now this is another .NET object, so if I run it, you'll see we get a flow layout panel. Check MSDN help, and what flow layout panel is a simple and quick way of organizing more controls downstream of it. So any child controls inside of a flow layout panel will automatically be laid out in rows and columns and spread out correctly. If you don't use something like a flow layout panel, you actually need to manage the positioning of any controls inside of it on your own. So if I try dumping these two list views inside of the left hand panel of the split container, and I just drop them in, they would have been right on top of one another. They would have just been dropped right on top one another, because you'd have to actually manage their position and tell it this is the location that you're going to be. Using a flow layout panel, it'll automatically handle that for you and spread things out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the left panel. Again, I've got parent here. I should probably put sender. Sorry, I didn't, but that's what I'm using. So let's just make sure I've written this correctly. Yep. So what I've done is I've set init left panel. I'm sending it to split containers panel 1. Creating a flow layout panel. Flow direction. And again, this is one of those cases where the flow direction property actually contains the object that's needed to put back into it again. So flow direction top down. So instead of trying to put them side by side, it'll go top down. Now, if I make these the correct width, it probably would have. But if I was side to side, it probably would have put it below anyways, because it'll fill up the row and then drop down to the next column. In this case, I can actually force it, you know, just go down and keep going down. When you check objects as well, you're going to get, here's the next one, is bounds. Items in .NET, UI items, have a bounds property. So bounds property is the actual rectangle. So if you can think of it as the position is the top corner, okay, and that's a location, and that needs basically a 0.2 value passed into it. Okay, as a point, which is a system drawing point. We'll probably get to that in a bit. And then you'd have to give it a size, a width, and a height. Well, another way to do that is with bounds. And bounds requires a rectangle. And let me go grab my function for building a rectangle. And drop this in here. And so here's my function for drawing a rectangle that I've written. Again, nice and simple. .NET system drawing rectangle. And this is built as a .NET object directly. And if I run it, you'll notice it gives me a constructor found. Don't have enough arguments, essentially. And what the rectangle is looking for is the position values. So the upper left-hand corner, the width, and the height. And that will now create an object that will contain a rectangle, starting with the position, and then the width and the height values. So again, I've got a nice little function that I just passed 2.2 values, a position, and the width and height, and it automatically builds me out rectangle. So the bounds property is going to be looking for that rectangle. And again, if you were to check that, it would tell you what it would need. It would tell you that it would need a system drawing rectangle. And the system drawing objects and classes basically are handled for all the kind of drawing methods that we're going to be using. So are you going to be drawing a line? Well, there's a ways to do that. You can draw something onto the screen. We're going to be drawing a little circle in. You're going to be using the system drawing tools that are in MSDN when you go and take a look at it. Border style, again, none of those cases that, it's telling you that the border style, when you look at it in here, it will actually feed back to you that it needs another object. And if we just simply check its own self and look at its properties, you'll find that the border styles can be set to none. In this case, don't give me a border. I don't want to see a border around it. I want it to be nice and clean. And then what we do is we actually add it. So parent is the left-hand panel from our split container. I should have called it sender. Again, I guess I was probably coding fast the last time. Parent is that split container's left-hand panel. And if we check the properties of that left-hand panel and we have a look at it, we can actually find out that there's a controls property. So there, I'll run that one again. And let me just find it real quick. So controls, and it has a system windows forms controls. So let's actually find out what more information we can find out about it just by checking our format props. And indeed, what we're looking at, we can get the count, the number of them. We can get the item, and then the count numbers, so we can actually get each item that's in it. And we can run a method called add, and all we have to do is send it some sort of system Windows Forms control item, and any control, so our list views and whatever else, tree views, that sort of thing. We can even do an add range and have an array of controls and pass them all in at once. So what I'm going to do then is I want to create my two list boxes, list views. So top list view, bottom one. So we've got a scene list and a controls list. And what we have is a scene list.net list view item. Okay, and again, I won't cover this much because you can go onto my website and get this information really quickly about how it's done. So what you'll see then is a bunch of settings for that list view. So that it is actually set up and has the needed settings, things like full row select and grid line, show me the lines across, and multi-select false so that I can't multi-select in here, columns and whatnot, and so how many columns and what those columns are named. So you'll notice it's called scene and what its width is. So if you check those, you can find it's pretty easy. Now what again we need to do is we need to set and put it in. And in this case, we use parent.controls.add and added our flow layout panel into our left-hand split container panel. And again, down here, what we're going to do is we're going to take our flow layout panel.controls.add and add in our scene list and drop it in. I'm going to comment out this line because it doesn't exist yet. And I'm going to comment out these two because they don't exist yet. We're going to get to these in 1 second. Next one, another list view, same thing. And I'm going to comment out those two. And this should run, keep your fingers crossed. Call needs function or class. DN size. Oh, we needed a size. Sorry. So I'm actually setting the size here. So same thing. What I've got is a size function. So this is going to work very similar to everything else. System drawing size, and it's 0.2 value. So essentially, it's the first part of the rectangle. So that's what a system drawing size object looks like. Let me just try running that again. There we go. So now it automatically setting up our two list boxes. I don't know if you're starting to notice this and looking at it. Essentially, using .NET to build your UIs like this, you can build very dynamic UIs because you can add and subtract controls, move them around, do everything you want with them. Unlike MacScript, that once you have a rollout, it's there. You can't actually add and subtract controls to it without having to rebuild the whole thing and have the whole thing redeveloped for you. With .NET, you can actually add a control, remove a control, move a control, whatever you like, as the script's running. So it's very, very easy to build truly dynamic UIs, and that is something that I do again a lot with the joystick control light system that I'm developing. It is very, very fast and dynamic the way it builds itself, so it makes it great option to go with .NET because it's so clean to work with in that sense. So does this make sense so far? Globally, yes. All right. Fair enough. Is this information too rudimentary for most of you? Yes or no? Is this new? Am I going down the right roads? Again, I want to try and tailor these classes for the group that's here. Now, we seem to have one student who's not, has not used it. So, good. That's good for you then, Charles. It's not too rudimentary. Anybody else? Okay. And how about the speed that I'm delivering at? Okay, excellent. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a quick break right now, and I'm just going to save down the recording, and then we'll you can always review after. Exactly, great. I'm just going to save this down, then we'll come back, and we'll start working with event handlers and whatnot, and working with those, okay? So let's just take a quick 5-minute break, all right? Get yourself another coffee or tea or whatever time of the day it is there, okay? Okay, so now let's get back to it and start looking at how some of this tool is going to go and how some of this is going to be working next. Actually, you know what? Let's just actually populate the other side. How's that? We'll do the population of the right-hand panel as well so that we have that working. And so, again, real simple. I'm going to run an init panel 2, basically a write panel and initialization. And that one is going to look pretty straightforward as well. So let's grab it. And I will put it up above the init left. And I'm going to comment out the event handlers. Oops. I said comment out the event handlers. And what we're going to use is a simple label. And a label is just an empty box for all intents and purposes. I've not actually seen any difference between it in the what's it called, paint box? No, paint, or no, sorry, picture box. Sorry, is the one I'm thinking about. I don't tend to use picture box because I haven't seen any difference, and it's shorter to type label. That's called laziness, I think. A label is just an empty box we can use, and that is going to be this box over here on this side. And again, it's got properties, so we're getting this joystick, and we're going to say back color, and we're going to set up the a size, so give it a size. And here's a case where we're going to be using, instead of using, I sort of took another direction on this. I could have used bounds, because bounds would actually set the screen is static right now. Can you see me moving the script window? Okay. I think it's because I wasn't moving, maybe. Instead of using the bounds, I've used two other properties. I've used size and location. So location being the first part of a rectangle, the position values, and the size being the width and the height. So I've set it in two goes here instead of using the dot bounds, just to sort of show it. Again, it could have been done either way, but now I need to make sure that I have my dot point. I don't think I have. No, I don't. So here's a dot point. So system drawing point with a 0.2 value returns to me a position. Okay, so nice and simple. Again, system drawing point. You tend to use that a lot when you're doing drawing stuff as well. And we set its size, we set its location, and a background image. In this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to forego this. This is pretty straightforward. If you wanted to do a system drawing brush, maybe we'll do it actually. Why not? Why not? I will add in. This variable. One second, I will explain it in a second. The very, very top, I'm going to add just another variable. Maybe we could actually add this one below it so it makes some sense. I'll just cut that back out of there and put it right below. So when the script first runs, what it's going to do is it's going to generate a few variables. UIinst, it's going to create a bitmap path, okay? And what I have in that location is this bitmap here that's in the background here. And so I just have a bitmap called joystick BG located in the correct spot. I'm going to use the bitmap path plus that to get me my full path to the bitmap. And we're going to use a .NET class system drawing bitmap dot from file. So that portion there creates the object. This is the class. And then we have to make the object from file and pass it the property that's needed, which is simply the path to the bitmap. So that's going to generate us, and again, if I just highlight that without the comma and run it, oops, of course, I'm going to have to highlight this and run it for that to work. .NET Object System Drawing Bitmap. Back down to here, and there's our bitmap being placed in a property called background image. So we can drop it in. And of course, then what I'm doing is I'm then adding sender, and this time I'm using sender instead of parent. Sorry, but sender.controls.parent. dot add. So essentially sender is the right hand panel of our split container. I haven't bothered adding a flow layout panel because I'm just adding one object in there, so it's not an issue for me to have to move things around. So we're putting it's straight in, so center.controls.add, and we're adding the joystick container. This shouldn't error and should give us a bitmap in the background. Good so far? And that red background is really starting to grind on my nerves, so we're going to go get rid of that. Let's just go and comment that out. There we go. No more red in the background. So now we want to start looking at is sort of how we're going to make this overall tool function and how it's going to actually get the information and set it and whatnot. So let's discuss that a little bit more. Just going to minimize these. On our teapot, got a bunch of those open. On our teapot again, we've got an attribute holder with a custom attribute definition on it. And in that custom attribute definition, I have four tracks of animation that I've created in a parameter block. But there's also a property you can't see here. So if I actually go and check that and just show you it, $modifiers, first one, joystick container. There is the custom attribute definition. There is an actual property I've stored in there as well, which is just storing a string called .xml. And .xml is storing this XML formatted string. So here's the string that was returned to me. Let me just make that a little bit larger, might be easier. And it has a basic root tags. And then it has two tags as children of that. And those tags are essentially the correspond directly with pairs of the properties that have been added. So if you look, we've got position X, and there's position X, there's position Y, and they're called X and Y, and the name position. So this name here, position, is what you're seeing right here in the controls. When we highlight one of these attribute holders, it's that word position is being pulled out of the XML file, being stored and held onto, displays the name position in the in this second list. And then when I grab the joystick control, or at least just click down on it and start moving it, what it does is it goes and gets the property position X in the custom attribute and sets its value to wherever my mouse is in the window. Same thing with the Y. When I switch over to rotation here, the word rotation, it goes and looks for the other two tracks of animation that are stored and now manipulates those two directly. So there's no real direct connection between this joystick control and the actual tracks of animation like you think of it in Mac. So if I actually had spinners for these custom attribute definitions, you'd wire up to the spinners. Really, you're not. Mac's script is handling all of this for you in a sense. Again, in Mac script, you create a parameter block item and the UI item to go with it. So you are not connecting to the spinner, you are connecting to the parameter, and the parameter is connected to the spinner in some way. So we're going to do all that work ourselves basically to get this to work and to function as it should. So does that make sense on how it's actually functioning, how the tool kind of works? Because that's kind of an important part of it, really. So let's take a look at that tool or that function that I generated, and let's drop that into our tool. So this is a little manual. I didn't actually do this we just need to call it essentially. I'll just drop the function header in too, make it real easy to get to. I don't think I called this joystick control, did I? No, it's JS tool, so we will go back up. Right there. So This function creates a custom attribute definition. Anybody here not created a custom attribute definition by hand? Okay, so definition, parameter block, our axes of position and rotation, variable XML. I create a string formatted in XML with our root tags and two tags inside called control. And then I stuff those into it. So when I actually set it up, all I had to do was just run this line of code, and basically it was dumping this custom attribute definition onto the object and then sticking the needed XML data into the XML string. Good? Okay. So let's go back down and start looking at our initializations again. So this is the init left panel. So this is the left-hand panel here, and we're going to start looking at initializing and setting up the list on this side. So populating this scene, the scene list. So I'm going to uncomment that, populate scene list, and go and grab that function. Is it? And we'll put that right above it. Should be good. So I can find it. So once it's made the list view item, and it's added it to the flow layout panel, we then run the function and pass the new list view item to it. And what it's going to do is it's going to go and run a couple of things. First off, it's going to go through the scene and it's going to collect all the joystick definitions. So it's going to search the entire scene and find anything that's called that joystick controller, what do we call it, a joystick container definition. And it's going to run around the scene and find it. So let's just get that function. I'll stick it in. Probably, I'll just stick it above it. It should be fine as far as scope goes. So here's a pretty standard nested for loop. Loop through all the objects. Check how many custom attributes are on it. Loop through those custom attributes at the object level. And check and see if any of them are named joystick container. If they are, append our defs. Array here. Then loop through all the modifiers, because we may have, the reason I did this is just sort of in case you decided to put it on the root of the object as opposed to the custom attribute holder modifier. So then we run through all the modifiers, do the same thing, basically check and see if any of them are called joystick container and append them and return all of the definitions found in the scene. In this case, in my current scene, there should be two definitions returned. So what we're going to do then is once we've collected all those definitions, we're going to set up an array of rows that we're going to be adding to our list view. And we're going to use, an item. So interestingly enough, in .NET, everything are these objects nested inside of other objects. So in this case, the actual item in the list isn't just a string like it is in MacScript listbox. It's an actual object in .NET. And an object in .NET can have properties, methods, events, and basically has a whole lot more you can do with it in itself just on that item. So to create the list view item, we need a systems windows forms list view item. And that'll actually generate us a list view item. Now the list view item takes one property to start with to make the object, and that's the name of it. And what we're going to do is as we're looping through all the definitions, I'm going to use custAttributes.getOwner and find out who owns it. And in this case, the owner of that custom attribute is the modifier itself, and we're going to get the name of the modifier. So these coming up here where it says attribute holder, that's just the name of the modifier. Change the name of the modifier, it'll change the name that's showing up here. The next thing we're going to use is the tag property. Tag property is really cool. This is something that every .NET object has, and allows you to be able to store data inside of every control for later use. And this is where it's very, very flexible in passing data around. So there's the tag object. Essentially, with .NET, you can stick any .NET object in there. Okay, you can just stick anything in there as long as it's .NET and not MacScript. Again, if it was the value 1, MacScript would convert it to a .NET object for you for the system int and be able to store it in there. What we're going to do is we're going to store MacScript custom attribute definition data in there. Well, custom attributes are not .NET. Okay, so I create the item li.tag, so the actual tag property of this item here, I'm going to stick in there the actual definition. So this is one of the definitions that we collected from the scene, x. And the way you do that is you use this keyword called .NET MacScript value. And again, look it up in the MacScript help, and you'll find that what it'll do is it'll stick a wrapper around any dot or any MacScript value type and allow you to be able to use it like a .NET object. It kind of sticks this just container around it and says so that .NET now thinks it's a .NET object. We could even stick a struct of data inside it. You could stick an array of data inside it. You could stick whatever you want inside of it. So in a lot of cases, I'm using this with a struct of data of all kinds of information. In this case, it's just one value that we needed. I'm going to then append our rows array with li, which is our actual list item. And we're going to go sender.item.addRange. And so sender is the actual list box, the list view, dot items. If you check the items property in it, there is an addRange method in this property. And then you pass it all of the array of rows. And again, arrays in MacScript are converted automatically as long as they have the correct .NET stuff inside them. Okay, so again, if it was an array of float values, it should work as well. I'm not sure I've tried that anytime recently, but it should work as well. So that's going to populate our scene. Let's see what I've forgotten here. Nope, how about that? Didn't forget anything. It's now populated and put those items in there. So what we need now is we need some event handlers. We need to set up event handlers for any object in Max or in .NET will have event handlers. So it isn't as specific as MacScript is, where it sort of, you may not have an event handler on something like a label. There's no event handler. Well, .NET's always got these event handlers and lots of them. And in this case, if we check our list view item, and again, I'll just go and do props. And we have a look at the event handlers. There are just a pile of event handlers. And what we need to do is find the correct ones that we're looking for. You had trouble transferring data using tag from CA to new window. Dennis had workaround. I don't get the need for a timer. I would have to look at it and see what he's doing there. So if you ask me, if we get to the question and answer period, ask me again, Charles, and I'll take a quick look at that and see what he's doing. I'm not sure what you were doing there. If Dennis answered it, I'm going to assume it's pretty correct. That guy's a pretty sharp cookie, so I think he's a whole lot sharper than I am. So we'll see if we can I can explain it to you at least. So there are things like key down, mouse up, mouse enter, mouse hover, mouse leave, mouse move, and whatnot. So what we do then to set up a .NET event handler is we use the MacScript command. You'll find .NET. Again, it's the structure in .NET or in MacScript language. It has methods, so add event handler. What are we going to add the event handler to? We're going to add it to the list view. So we're going to add it to the list view item. As a string, you need to pass then which event you're going to be using. So we're going to be using mouse up, which is right here. And then we have to tell it what function we're going to call when this event takes place. So it's going to be dn scene list mouse up. Let me just grab that and over here, find it. And I will stick this right above here again, just for easy access. So here's my mouse up event. Now, when you create a function for events in .NET, they take two arguments by default. And essentially, the first one is the actual item itself. So when the mouse is clicked, in this case, on the mouse up, so the mouse is released, this function is called. Where'd it go? There it is. And sender will contain the item that you clicked on. Okay, so it'll actually hold the item that was clicked on. And in this case, it's the actual tree view. Okay, so it's the full list view item that's actually being clicked on, not the item. I kind of wish it was the item; it'd be easier. It also takes an argument, and essentially, if you go and check in using our format props function, and you format props on the argument here, what you'll find is that it returns back a whole bunch of information as well. So I'm just going to comment all of that out. I'll just use that format props I have there, and what does that call it? JS tool, correct? I think that's what I called my structure. So my structure, you'll notice that I have to get access to my format properties function that is inside of the structure somewhere. Where is it? Up here. It's inside of my structure. And I'm having to go in through the structure to the format props. Even though I'm in what looks like I'm in scope, event handlers in .NET are kind of held outside. They're again in their own little scope world. And so once you're inside of this event handler function, it is no longer just sort of inside of that structure anymore. Okay, so you're going to have to call back into the structure to get to that format tool. This is part of the reason why I use structures, is that this format props function isn't sitting floating around globally. I mean, it is now because I evaluated it globally, so I could use it in the other page. But essentially, when this tool runs, it's not sitting floating around globally. It's nested inside of this tool that I've generated and the structure. So it becomes one of the methods I can call inside of it. I can then pass to it things like the argument, okay, and whatnot. And if we actually run this now, I should be in a position where if I click on the item, you can see the listener flicking. And what that is actually doing is feeding back information. So every argument for every event handler could give you back different information. You need to check them and see what there actually is, depending on what the event handler is. The arguments will be different. So in this case, the dot button, I can actually find out which mouse button was clicked. I can find out how many clicks, the location you clicked, the XY position you clicked, all kinds of information can be had, as well as some functions can be run inside of it as well. I'll just comment that back out again. So, sender.selectedItems is a property of the list view. Dot count, how many of them there? If it's equal to one, I probably didn't need to do this check because I actually set it up so that you couldn't multi-select. Okay, but it looks like I overdid it and decided to check anyways, just in case something happened. But it's checking to see if any more than one is picked. What I want to do is go and get the definition now. So this item that's actually in the list view actually stores in its tag property the definition. Okay, so when I click on this item, I need to populate the second list down here with the items that are found. So what I do is I go and get the sender.selectedItems, item 0. And here's something to note right off the bat if you haven't been working with .NET. MacScript is one based in its arrays. Just about every other language, I'm not sure I've run into any other language that is one based. Every other language is 0 based. So when you ask for an array's count and it says 1, the first item in the array is 0, okay? So I know that I've only got one selected item, and so sender.selectedItems, a property, has another property called .item. 0 is the item in that one, so the first one that's selected, because it could be multiple again if we had a multi-select enabled. And so that now is returning to me this first item in the list. It's .tag property. And then you ask for the value. So once you've added a .NET MAX script value, the .NET MAX script value would be returned if I just add for .tag. Okay? So we can actually do that, and we can just hit, for instance, and hang on a second. You can see that it's returning back this joystick container, but it's a .NET MAX script value, and this is one of the this is the item that's in it that's it's telling you there is. So what I can do then is to then ask for its value. Its value dot value will return back the actual joystick container. That means using that joystick custom attribute definition. So once I've got that definition, I can then go and get its properties of that definition. One of the properties is def, and the guy stored it in a def. Def.xml is that XML file, so it's that string, that XML string that we were that we placed in there that contained information about what the control was to be called and what tracks of animation it would drive. Okay. So I do some checks just to make sure the string's not empty and it's not undefined. And then we're going to get into creating XML reading and be able to read the XML data. So reading XML data is going to take a little more work than some of the .NET for the reason that we have to use .NET.loadAssembly. And what this means is that the system XML component of .NET isn't automatically running in MAX script. It's not already going in the background. And we may have to initialize it and get it running first. Whereas things like the forms and whatnot, they're already there waiting to be used. So we actually have to go and load the assembly. If you were to go through C# and create your own assembly, create your own .NET object and whatnot, you'd have to do the same thing. You'd have to say .NET.loadAssembly and the path to that assembly and say, load this up for me. Then we create the .NET object. Now that we have it running and we have that assembly running, we can say system.xml. .xml document. So the first line loads up the assembly. The second line actually creates a .NET object that we can then use and call all of its functions and whatnot from. So there's all of our properties, methods, and events that can actually happen inside of it. So you can actually get an event to be fired on something happening in an XML file, which is pretty cool. So what we're going to look at is loading up and reading our XML file as a string. And so XML doc.loadXML, basically there's a few of them. Where are they again? Right there. The load .load will actually load it up from a drive and read a file in for you, so you can basically .load and pass it a file string. So you pass it a path to a file that's on your drive, and it'll read that up. Load XML file will take a string that's formatted as XML and turn it into an XML object for you. So the load XML, and then we're passing it the string that we pulled right out of the definition. The next thing we're doing is control tags, xml.document element, get elements by tag name. I don't know if you guys have used anything like JavaScript and whatnot for building web pages and everything. You get the same sort of functions when you're trying to read HTML and XML using it as well. So get elements by tag name, we're going to dig into our formatted XML file here. And it's going to grab any control or any node inside of the XML file that's called control, which are going to be our two controls. So we pass it the name control, and it's in this case, it should return an array of two items because we have two items in there for each of our controls, and they're called position and rotation. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to populate the second list. So now that we've gone and grabbed those the XML and grabbed the two tags out of the XML file called position and rotation that have those names, we're then going to go and run the populate control list, which should be right there in my this is probably going to be good enough. Stick it there. And same thing. It's a list view, so I really don't need to cover it much, but one of the things I'm going to do is do the items.clear. So clear it out. So when I click on the next one, I don't end up with the original ones in there as well. So it's going to clear it. Same sort of thing. I'm going to run through the control tags. So if you notice, I'm populate control list, control tags, which is an array of the controls. And I pass it the definition as well, in case I need that. So the definition that I managed to get all this from. So I'm going to pass it on to the second items here. So what I'm going to do is run through those controls, create items for each one of those. And then again, what you notice what I'm doing is I'm using the tag property with the .NET max script value again. But this time I'm going to pass it an array of items. In this case, I'm going to pass to it each control tag, so in this case, the first control tag, so the one, the actual tag item in the XML file, okay? And that's an object again. That tag item isn't just a string we have to do some string parsing on. It's an item, it's an object that we can actually grab properties from. And we're going to pass it the definition in case we need it as well. So if we want to go and do anything with that definition, and we click on position here, we can actually get what item in the XML file was used to create it, and we can get the definition that it was stored inside of. And then add it to the list. Click on it, it's populating the list, and it's storing that data now in the tag properties sphere. So basically we've taken the information from the attribute holder, the custom attribute, stored it in the attribute holder. When we click on it, we're stripping its data out of the XML property in there, storing it in this one. Now when we click on this one, we can then pass that information over to our joystick control here, so the joystick knows what to work on. Using the tag properties like this makes it really clean, and there's no guesswork. I know that when I click on this, it's been passed into here. Click on this, this specific information will be passed here, and I don't have to try and like parse arrays. Hey, which one did I click on, and which one should this work on? It just knows because it keeps passing this data on in a more refined fashion each time. Does that make sense, guys? Or am I putting you all to sleep? Because I'm not seeing any comments or anything coming up. So are you all snoozing on me? You are sleeping, Charles. Sorry to wake you. Sorry. What time is it there? Oh, geez, I would be sleeping myself. Where are you again? You're in Australia? Must be on the you're on the other side of the planet. Yep. Wow. All right. Sorry for being so late. I can't help the whole thing with the world being round and everything. Probably would have been easier if it was flat, right? If it was like they originally thought it was, we'd all be in the same time zone. I say we lobby for that. Okay, so what we've done is we've passed our data over to our control, and we've made that come over. Now let's go back down. We created and started all this with this one event handler. Now, something to note with event handlers and .NET in itself, it ends up in the scope of Max Script. So if Max Script does a garbage collection, we can end up with a problem, because when it does the garbage collection, it could actually wipe out things like our event handlers, okay? It could look at it and say, well, hey, this isn't needed, and get rid of the event handler and blow it out of memory. So that's a bit of a problem. So really what we want is we want to make sure that when we're doing this, that we get our .NET out of Max Script's garbage collection and let .NET manage its own garbage collection. So that's where this next line comes in handy here, is .NET.setLifetimeControl. So the .NET, again, the Max Script structure for getting into the .NET commands. and set lifetime control allows us to be able to tell any .NET object what scope it should be in. And in this case, so we're saying set lifetime control, the list view, and we're telling it to be in .NET. You know, I've never actually set it to MaxScript. I think it's MaxScript. Look it up. There's two options to put there, but number sign .NET is the puts it into the .NET scope. So you'll notice I do that as we go down. We do it on all the event on all the nodes that we've got event handlers running on to make sure that they don't get garbage collected by accident on us. Again, it's because the scope of those event handlers ends up outside of our tool. So if the tool gets garbage collected for things it's not needing, it can blow away it'll look at these things floating around out there and say, hey, let's get rid of these. They're not needed inside that tool, okay? The next one is the second list. So we're going to set up our event handler, mouse up again when we click on our second list, and mouse up, and we're going to set the lifetime control on it, and we are going to go find this function. So here's our event handler that's going to be running on the second list. And again, it's going to do this arbitrary check for whatever reason I put it in there to check and make sure there's only one object picked. And it's then going to go in and get dig in dnjoystick.tag. Okay, so what I'm doing here, and I'm going to have to go in and change something, do something up here. So what's happening now is I've created a bit of a shortcut. I created a variable. Just at the top, which is DN joystick. Now, if you remember, that DN joystick was generated. Sorry, let me actually just put a flag on that so I can get back to it. DN joystick was created when we initialized the right-hand panel. So this is our DN joystick, the label here. And just to make it fast and simple to get to, I created a variable that I could access quickly so that when it's generated, it's sitting directly inside of the structure, so that it's sitting right there. So now when I go down and do the populate control list, where was it again? Control list, mouse up. Let me just put a flag on it. I can say jstool.dnjoystick and get direct access to this label really quick and simple. All right, so just a quick way of getting to it. What I do then is I take the selected items, the tag property that I've stored in this item here, and just pass it straight over to the tag property of the label when I click on it. So when I change it up, it simply has changed up the information that needs to be clicked on. Okay, the information that's going to be updated when the joystick is changed. So I just dump it over. From there, what I do is I do some options, and we'll get back to these. Let me just I should have named it the same. It would have been a whole lot easier. Oy, oy, oy. It would have been a lot easier. Okay, so what I do next, and I'm just going to go in, should we even discuss this right now? Yeah, why not? Okay, just, sorry guys, I'm just thinking about what order is best to describe this in. What I do then is just use standard access via XML. So the actual properties that I'm storing here is the XML data that's being stored in it about that item, right, that I'm clicking on here. We can actually access the joystick tool.tag, we've passed it now over to the joystick. I could have passed it out of here as well. Dot value, the first one in it, if you remember, was the actual XML tag, the XML node that I placed in there. And again, XML has got properties and methods and whatnot, so it's got a method called getAttribute. So I can tell it, go and get the attributes from it. And again, if you look at the format of our XML, this item here has several properties, name, X, and Y. So this is where this name came from, is I can pull it right out of here and say, what should that item be called, the dot name property. And back down. So what I can do is go get the X value. So the X value is going to be referring to this track here, or any one of those tracks, essentially. So there's the X, position X. So that has to be named correctly with the attribute, custom attribute definition. So I know which one to drive. So go and get the attribute X, go and get the attribute Y. And go and get the definition and just dump it into a variable to make it quick and easy. It's in the second array value in the tag property. And then I can go and get the property value. So this is get attribute. So I'm getting X, and what it's returning back to me is the whole property. So I can grab the whole thing. And from that, definition, so I'm getting back the name of it, right? The value of the attribute, sorry. In this case, it'd be like position X. And then I can use the simple Mac script commands, get property, set property, and whatnot, to be able to manipulate that directly in the custom attribute definition. So get property def X, so the definition, okay? So go grab the definition, go get the, in this case, let's say the position X. Let's store that value. And in this case, mouse over joystick. I have to think about what this part's doing. And then what I'm doing here, I believe, is updating it all. So this is a bunch of the funky math to update the joystick. So as soon as you click on it, it updates to where it's supposed to be. So basically, I'm getting the values from the custom attributes and then applying them back and painting where the circle should be. And let me see what this mouse over joystick, I totally forgot to check this one out, guys. Sorry. Oops. Find next. Oh, I remember what this is. Okay, this is a variable, and we'll get into this as we start to work on the joystick start. This is a variable I'm storing to store the point. So what I'm doing is I'm actually storing a point at which the mouse has actually been clicked, using the information from the actual parameters here that I've clicked on. So I'm storing them into a variable. We'll get into that next. So let's hold off on those. And then what I do is I invalidate this control and I update the control. And update is going to force the painting. And the painting is going to come next. So let's have a look at painting and running the event handlers on the actual control. We good so far, guys? Or is this just way too fast? I'm trying to cover an enormous amount inside of a very short amount of time. And again, I know you can review it back. So hopefully that will get it for you if you watch it a whole bunch of times. Anybody else want to pipe in there? Good, bad, indifferent? Okay. All right. Let's take another little quick break so I can save this down again, and then we'll get into creating the event handlers and everything for the actual. I'll be going over invalidate and whatnot as we start working with the actual joystick itself. You'll be getting the invalidate and the update and what that's doing and how the paint event handler works and everything. Okay, so I'll be back in just a couple 5 minutes, and we'll start on the next little bit. Okay, back to the third portion then. So what I've just done is I commented out this section here that is basically updating the joystick control part of it whenever a new item is picked in the controls list for now until we get it up and running. So now what we want to do is we want to work on the event handlers for the actual joystick control side of it, and start doing some drawing and whatnot and figuring out what to do with this. So let's go and find where the split container, knit left panel, Where was it? There it is, a knit write panel. So the initialize write panel, function, initialized this and drew us bitmap in the background. So it got all that running. Now we have to start adding event handlers. We're going to add several event handlers. Right off the bat, what I'll start with is two, mouse down and mouse move. So mouse down is going to be pretty straightforward. As we click down on it, we're going to be able to register where we click. And if you notice, the little circle jumps over to where the mouse is. And of course, then as the mouse starts to move over it, what happens? All right, so we need to have both of those. So I'll go and find both of those events. Down, and there is our mouse down. So here's our mouse down function, pretty straightforward. Again, two arguments are automatically passed. We don't have to do it here. We just tell it what function it is on the mouse down. And so our function sender, the actual item that's being passed in, so that's our joystick control, our label, and then an argument that contains information again. And so the argument for this is very similar as the properties for it. It will contain things like where the mouse is and whatnot. So the arg.location is actually telling you where the mouse is. So if I actually print that, that's actually just get rid of this one here a second so they don't get any errors. And we're not getting updates. We're not calling something. Sorry, I missed something in my rush. So we need the event handler, mouse down, mouse up. That's the controls, mouse up. Joystick control. Seamless, mouse up. So what is not working here, guys? Help me out. Joystick populate control list. Populate control list. Oh, and now it's gonna cause me grief. Let me fix this first. Find out what's going on. My old error checking method. Are we getting yups printed? No, it doesn't look like it. Populate control list. Scene list. Did I mouse up? Scene list mouse up. Oop, not in that one. Scene list mouse up. What am I missing, guys? Okay, that works. Scene list mouse up. Joystick control. There it is. Joyce, sorry. You notice I'm. JS tools again. It would have been easier if I actually. No unknown populate control list. And I need the populate control list function. Thought we actually had that. We do. Undefined JS. Oh, JS tool. No wonder. Items at undefined. Oh, and that was the other one I did. I also held, I forgot, the DN control list is this list view here. I also held a variable of it. Oops. at the top. There we go. Sorry, so I also held a variable just of this list box here, again, just to make my life easy, so that it would pop up. You know, you can just get to it fast and simple. So, sorry about that. So, I basically am holding one for the joystick control, one for the controls list currently. And where were we? We were, oh man, it's hard to think sometimes, isn't it? Mouse down. Thank you. Joystick mouse down. Now, where is that? That's back up at the top. There it is. Okay. Sorry about that. So we should be able to get that working, and I should be able to get system drawing points returned. So when I click, it's returning a system drawing point, which is a 0.2 value, X and Y, for wherever I'm clicking on the screen. Now again, I'm going to do JS tool. Dot mouse over joystick. So what I actually did is I stored a little variable here called mouse over joystick, and it creates a 0.2 value when it first runs using my DN point function. So it's creating a .NET point value. But essentially what's happening then, as soon as the person clicks down, I'm setting that location, okay? And then what I do is I do a sender invalidate and a sender update. And invalidate basically invalidates this box and tells it that it can be ready to be redrawn. And then I say update it and force an update to happen. So when you click down on it, or you're moving around on it, or you're clicking on something over here that's going to update it and tell it when to update, what you need to do is you need to first invalidate it. So tell it it's ready to be updated, and then force an update. So that's basically what the invalidate's doing. And what that invalidate and update doing is it's firing a paint event.
Sorry, I just need to cough. 1 second.
It's firing off what's called a paint event. So if you look at the the event handlers, there's also a paint event. Let's first add the joystick move so that we have it in there, and then we'll discuss it in a second. There's the move function. We'll get to this. And let's get to the paint event. And I'm going to set the lifetime control as well so that the life, so it doesn't get garbage collected. So the paint event is the one that is the most important. Now what we're calling that is joystick draw. And it's going to do the drawing for us with, there we are. And so let's discuss this paint event. Joystick draw is our paint event. And what it does is whenever the control is updated, even in this case, when I have it behind and then in front, it actually has to redraw this. Windows has to have to go and redraw this window when it gets moved to the front. It's not just always in the back there. It has to now know to draw it. So as soon as it does that, it's actually firing off this paint event. Now I'll just do a print argon here, for instance. And you'll notice that every time it moves to the front, it's firing off that paint event. You can see that it's getting fired off. Anytime I actually move or click, it's firing off a paint event as well, and it's now just going to spam my listener heavily. I always love it when I forget something like that in a tool that spams the listener, and I wonder why my rig's slow. Suddenly realize that I'm getting some print statement out to the listener every time you touch it. So in this case, if we do format props, and we'll go JS tool, tool dot. Arg and get it to actually update. What it's actually giving us now is the properties, methods, and events and whatnot for the actual paint event, for the argument that's being passed in. And one of the things that's in there is graphics. And graphics drawing is the GDI drawing methods that are in .NET, slowly being replaced by WPF, by the way, and the way that WPF is kind of a whole new system, kind of like the same sort of thing, but it tends to be faster. But right now in MacScript, I'm not finding it faster, so I'm still using the GDI drawing methods. So what we're going to do is we're just going to make a variable real fast up here that's going to be called g. arg.graphics. So we're just holding the graphics item in here so that we have it. And let's just go and do a format prop on it. So doing format props on the graphics item, you'll notice results in a whole lot of good stuff. And what it's returning to us here our methods for drawing, you know, there's the properties that I don't think we're using any of these. We could actually set some things like smoothing mode and whatnot to make it look cleaner and everything. And interpolation mode, take a look at those for actually setting the anti-aliasing and whatnot around the drawing. I don't think I'm actually doing it. It's all aliased. But if I actually set some of these, I can make it look all nice and smooth. So then when you look down at the methods, you have things like draw bezier, draw arc, draw curve, draw image. And in my case, I usually do use a draw image and draw a little target on screen, which is a little bitmap that's been stored again. What we're going to do is we're going to do a draw circle, and we're going to draw in a circle or an ellipse, fill ellipse, and an ellipse. We're going to use a brush and a rectangle. So let's go down and take a look at it then. Let me just comment that back out just so it doesn't keep running. What we're going to use to draw that little red circle is g dot fill ellipse. Fill ellipse with what? I'm surprised joystick control. I think it's getting it from the other script here that's running. JS tool dot target brush. Now target brush, I'm just going to go and pull what I've written on the other side out. Give me a second. Target brush. What we need is a target brush. And I'll put that back up with my other .NET goodies. And so we're going to build a brush. So when you start doing drawing, you have to start building certain other items. And it's good to build them in advance. Right inside my paint event, I could have created this. But that means every single time it paints, it's recreating this target brush. Because it needs to know what to brush on. And again, if you take a look in the .NET and the MSDN help, you'll find a .NET object, system drawing. And if you look through the system drawing stuff, you'll find things like brush. This is a bit of a confusing one. When you check it, you'll find system drawing brush because that's what it's asking for. It's looking for a brush. You actually have to define what kind of brush as well. So system drawing solid brush in this case, so a solid painted brush. And when you define a brush, you need to tell it what color it's going to be. Okay, so what color is this brush going to be? And this is creating our target brush. So again, using our target brush now, we can start painting into our paint. So fill ellipse is looking for a brush. Let me just get back to my, and where is it? Fill ellipse. We're looking for a system drawing brush to be passed in, and the actual system drawing rectangle. So again, the rectangle was the position and the size of what we're going to be drawing, correct? So we need to basically tell it what color, how you're going to paint it in, how you're going to fill it in, and of course, where are you going to paint this? So we also have our JS tool DN rectangle. And let me just grab that. So what the fill ellipse is saying is create a fill ellipse, make it the color we want it to be. In this case, it's going to be red. Where are we going to paint it and what size is it going to be? So as an ellipse, if we made this rectangle wider, obviously we'd get it an oval shape. In this case, I've kept it a circle. Now I want that little circle to be 30 by 30 in its size, and we need to figure out where it's actually going to paint it. Well, it's going to paint it. Remember, we have this mouse over joystick variable. So when I click down it actually is storing the point at which I clicked on in this variable. It then does an invalidate and an update, and the update then fires off the paint event. And the paint event then has to go in and make an ellipse, fill it in with red, go and get the value, or go and create a rectangle using that mouse over joystick position that we're storing. Minus 15 in the X and minus 15 in the Y. And that's just so that when I click, if I didn't do that, my mouse would actually be about here on it, because that's the actual position of the drawing that's taking place. So because it's 30 wide and 30 high, I'm having to push it back 15 and up 15 so that it's actually in the middle. That makes sense, I assume. So this is what the paint event does. The paint event allows you to be able to paint stuff into it. You can get paint bitmaps in there. You can paint shapes in there, all kinds of things. And I have a little bit of information on my website about .NET Drawing. And I only got it partly done, but essentially this entire dialog here, this is a .NET form that's been popped up, and everything in it has been painted through the paint event for the form. And I'm just painting everything in there, painting text, rotating it, formatting the text, and creating gradient ramps and lines and other text. And basically everything in there has just been done through the GDI plus drawing method. So that's not a bitmap, it's doing it on the fly. Now in the mouse move event, what we're going to do is we're going to find out what button has been pressed. So the arg, if we checked again, which we checked before, the argument had a dot button property. And again, it returns an object. And again, if we check what kind of objects it has a dot left object. So it checks to see that the left has been picked. So if we say arg.button is equal to arg.button.left, we know that our left button has been picked. Instead of a right button click, if I right click on it, it looks like it's only working because I didn't check it in the mouse down event. I only checked it on the mouse move event. So it's kind of incomplete, so I should make this check as well in the above. So I could easily just copy that up. Wait, and I'm getting some system drawing solid color in line. Let me find out. I should have tested something before I did that. Solid color, DN color. Oh, that needs to be below, sorry, my color values. Let me pull that out, put it down here. There you go. Sorry, it's calling on this DN color function, which wasn't in scope. So now when I down click, it's not doing anything because it's checking to make sure that it is indeed the correct click that's happening. And let's go and call the correct tool names. That's good. So what it's doing now is it's going in and it's setting this variable that I've got here. Again, based on, it's creating a .NET point with our .NET point function, and it's sending the arg.location.x and arg.location.y that it's actually using. Now, interestingly enough, I don't think I needed to do that, but arg.location returns a point. So my guess is, I have no idea why I did that. That should work as well. So arg.location, if you check the properties on it, it should be a point value that's being actually returned. So why I was making the end point with it, I have no idea. It obviously, I was, you know, talking too much and not thinking about what I was doing. Sender.invalidate and then sender.update. So what I'm doing is I'm invalidating that control, and then I'm updating it and firing the update, which again fires the paint event to chase it around. Sender.tag.undefined. And then what I'm doing is I'm doing the work to actually control the properties of the properties in the custom attribute definition that we've wired to. So back to that. So now we actually have to drive it. So if I actually comment this out, it won't drive anything. So what I'm doing is, and this is the reason why I've passed the values around to tag properties, is now when I click and drag on here, It obviously knows what its own tag properties are in there. It goes and gets the X, the name of the X. So what is the actual, get it as a name value, because set property in MacScript means a name property. So go and get the X, which is position X, for instance. Go get the Y, which is position Y, for instance. Get the definition. So we've got the definition just in a variable. And then do set property on what? The definition. Which property? The X. And what's the value that's being sent to it? The arg.location minus center.width. So we actually have to pass it I'm dividing it by two to cut it in half, right? So I'm just simply setting the properties directly on the attributes. You guys follow that? This, in theory, should actually function now and do what it needs to do. So essentially, this tool is already in position of working and functioning correctly as far as that goes. So the nice thing, again, just as a recap, is being able to store that information. Looks like I got a pile of them open here. Is be able to store the information about the scene and what we need in each of the tag properties and pass it around from item to item until we actually end up using it. And again, it's a nice clean way of getting that data passed around the scene. Now the problem with what we have is if we animate any of this and scrub, this isn't updating currently. But you'll notice the one that I wrote first is, the one up here is actually updating and running again in the update. So what we need to do is we need to create an update for this and actually be able to send the update. And really all we need to do is be collecting and storing information about how we're going to draw that. And we need to figure out where it needs to be drawn. So we need to now create a new point to draw it on, and then invalidate the control again and update it. Okay, so instead of generating this value with a mouse down, we need to now generate it as the time slider slides. So let me just check and see where I've done this over on the other side here. We're going to use a registered time callback. Let me go to the bottom here. We're going to use a register time callback, and the other one we're going to do is we're going to get rid of it. So has anybody used register time callback here? Or callbacks at all? Or how about this? Has anybody not used a callback? Maybe that's a better question. Who has not used a callback? You have not, Matt? Anybody else? I think everybody else has gone to sleep on me. Sorry, guys. Callbacks in MacScript are very handy. What they allow you to be able to do is get information back. So if we actually go and check for... Sorry, I'm running the web... version here. Check for our general event callback mechanisms. Essentially what callbacks do is you can actually have, in this case, this is the callbacks.addScript. These callbacks basically, there's piles of them again, all sorts of them, that when things happen in your scene or in Max, you can actually get it to go and run a function based on all kinds of things. Pre-render frame. So before it renders a frame, go and run me this Mac script if this callback is running. You know, when file links happen, when files open, file post open. So actually, after a file's opened, go and do something. I actually run this one a lot in productions all the time to fix problems. The animators will come to me and say, hey, look, we've got this problem with this character rig and this one, thing doesn't work on it. And then I'll go, okay. And I go, okay, it's fixed. And they go, how'd you fix that? That character is in 200 files. And I haven't fixed it. What I've done is I've put a callback into the system that runs a function to fix it. Every single time they open the file, it checks to see if that character is in the scene. If the character is in the scene, it fixes it. So they think it's all been fixed. It's not. It's just fixed every single time it gets opened. Callbacks can be very handy. Now, there's other callbacks. One of them is register time callback. And what register time callback will do, well, it'll actually run every single time the time changes in the timeline. So anytime the time changes, it's going to run this function. Now, what we also want to do is make sure that we kill time backs, callbacks and stop them. So you want to make sure you remove them when they're used in other ways, or this one, in this case, it's unregister time callback, and get rid of it when the tool closes. If you forget to do that, Max will start getting very slow as the tool gets opened and closed each time and it's trying to do things, or it could be throwing errors like crazy. Time change callback function is going to look like this for us. And this time change callback is going to go in and check and just set a variable called sender. And what it's going to check is that variable that we stored at the top that represents our joystick control. So there's our joystick control. I'm just dumping it in sender just to make my typing faster and easier. Sender.tag, so get the tag property. So again, this is why I've passed this data over to the tag property. All I have to see is check and make sure that indeed this label here exists. And all I need to do is make sure indeed that the tag data is not undefined, meaning that the first time the script is run, it hasn't been defined yet. So just make sure that the tag property is indeed defined. And if it's defined, then I can go and get the XY data from the XML tag. I can get the definition out of there as well that I've stored. I can get the get property, use get property in Max script to go and get the value of the X in the custom attribute definition. I can go get the value of the Y, and I can then go and set my mouse over variable. So that variable that was at the top, if you remember. And we'll just make sure these are all correct. And again, set its value for the value that needs to be set. And I'm going to set it with that offset again divided by 2. Okay, so you'll find as you play with it, you're going to have to offset the values to make sure that it gets drawn in the right place. So I'm going to create that point value from wherever the values actually respond to me here. So go and get these values, create a point, and invalidate and update the joystick again. And then it draws it. So once I run this again, come on, mouse. My mouse is sticking for some reason. There we go. Right now it doesn't do anything because it doesn't know which one to update. I go and pick one, and it should update now. So now it's running a callback to constantly update it. Pick the next one, and it should update it. Now, I don't have any rotations animated, so let's animate its rotation values. And now it'll animate that second one working as well. If you notice, when I click on it, it's not updating the list again. And this comes back to that piece that we left commented out somewhere right about here. And this is basically doing the same thing. It's now checking that when we click on the control list item, it's going and setting that mouse over variable. It's coming up with a point value to actually store in it. It's invalidating it, updating it so that it updates. So again, we can run this. And as soon as I click on it now, it should jump to the correct location for wherever it needs to be and update itself. So that's essentially the tool functioning at this point. It actually happened much faster than I thought it would, guys. I shouldn't have talked so fast early on. So we have more time for a question and answer than we probably would have before. So I'll answer anything at all, essentially, to work it out. The idea is this tool was sort of a predecessor to the joystick light tool that I'm working on. It kind of provided a very quick and easy way, as I thought about doing this .NET class, was how do you actually teach what can be done with .NET and UI that's fairly simple? This is fairly simple. It's a very simple two lists and a label, basically, but it's covered a lot of different elements that were needed to get there, and created a neat little joystick control, because there was always a lot of discussion at times about how do you actually generate and create a joystick control. Using Mac script. And this is a, a pretty good way of doing it, I think. So any questions about what we've done? Or are you guys all still asleep there? Okay, Matt, the .NET library is huge. What strategies do you guys use to find new objects? Google. That's about all I can say is that, yeah, it is huge. There's actually a ton of information on CG Talk now in the Mac Script forum. We've been discussing it for a number of years now, really since it started to get implemented in 2009, mostly. The discussions go back probably to 2008, Macs, but 2009, you really started hearing discussions about it. And from there's a ton of comments about how to do things. So I would suggest starting to check there or email me and ask, and I might be able to point you in the right directions. There's a lot of information there. But there's one of the things to do is start, if you don't use C Sharp, or VB, .NET or whatever, learn one of those. That helps. C Sharp is the way I've gone reading it. And it's funny because before I even started trying to write C Sharp, I was reading C Sharp, not unable to, unable to write it because there's a lot of information for C Sharp writing the .NET tools and whatnot in it. And it's actually very straightforward. You can actually garner a lot of information, but you have to convert some of that information over to how MacScript wants to deal with .NET making objects and everything. So it takes some hacking around, but usually you can find what you need. And then you can use CG Talk or the area or whatever to be able to figure out how to implement that in Mac script and how to rewrite it the right way. A bit off topic, how would you create a limit controller to define movement of control along a specific shape, for example? I have no idea, Charles, what you're asking there. Can you be a bit more clear? I can only assume you're typing right now, Charles. Are you? To a path? If I want to be able to move this joystick and have this control move along a path, is that what you're asking? That's simple because, again, what we've got is custom attribute definitions. All I have to do is wire the percent along path to one of these. Simple as that. So I could even have it doing two things here. Let me just go and do line. I'll create a sphere, let's say. Come on. I'll put it on a path constraint. Get rid of its keys. Pop open my param wire. Load up the driver. So it'll be the second teapot here. And attributes, we'll use the X position for it. And load up the percentage on the other side. And connect it up. And I should be in a position now where, I forget which one it is. It'll be this one's position. Now drives it up and down the path. Looks like it's jumping from end to end pretty quick because it needs to be toned down a whole lot. I mean, like on mesh facial controls and shape of eye for EG. Oh, you mean just how do I control a shape? Same way, just wire its position values. So you actually wanted to control you've got floating eye controls. Is that what you're saying? And you want to be able to drive them through this as well as through on screen? Use a two-way wire or copy controllers or, you know, like instance controllers would do it. Does that answer your question, Charles? Essentially, the tool I've just written is just custom attributes that's being driven. So you can drive anything with it in any way, shape, or form that you can hook up to a custom attribute. So however you want to, you know, connect to these this bank of custom attributes that's been generated. And that's it. You know, however you want to do it, two-way wire to it, instance controller if you want to have control on both sides, or script controllers, whatever you like, to it. But so essentially, that's what makes this flexible is it's not actually trying to drive something really, really specific. You could do that. You can make it really specific. But in this case, it's a little cleaner. There's no errors. It's not name dependent either, if you notice, this tool. It doesn't require that it's an object to be named specifically. Again, in the XML file, you could have defined the object and the track or something in that XML node and done it that way so that it'll actually check and see if a specific object exists in the scene and then drive a very specific track on it with the value. That would be a way to do it as well, but that would be name dependent at that point. Which, you know, again, is fine if that's okay with you in your scene, if you know that the naming conventions aren't going to be duplicated and that they're going to stay, the same. I mean, the control itself is rectangular. I want it to be curvilinear. Oh, you mean you want it to make a circle? Curve in linear. So you want to constrain basically this so it doesn't go too far and creates a circle and only goes out to the outside area. Yeah, okay. Well, yeah, then you're going to have to do the math. A little bit of cos and sine to get your values would do it. And stop it from going too far. So, yes, you can write... write the value, write it so it you know can't go too far for sure. You can easily make circle controls. It takes a little bit more math though to do that, obviously, because everything's in X and Y. So you're just going to have to use cos and sine and figure out the circle and limit it. If you're using a limit controller, you can do the same thing. You can use a cosine and the limit values and basically drive those with a limit so that it's a circle and won't go too far based on each other's values. So, you know, limit the X based on the Y, if you know what I mean. So, yeah, that's all possible. But, you know, I'd have to stop and think about how to show you that in specific right now. But, yes, it can be done without a problem. I've done it before. I rarely have bothered, but, yes, it can be done. You can also do triangles, too, for that fact, right? And create triangle controls. Can you limit to the background image alpha? Could you limit it to the background image alpha? Ooh. So you're kind of saying, could this control only stay inside of an alpha? I guess. You probably could, because you could do a get pixel. Get the pixel that you're over top of for the alpha and determine whether it's black or white and determine whether or not you're allowed to move into the black or the white, whichever way you decide to do it. If it's just going to be a circle, I'd use cosine because it would be a hell of a lot faster. If you wanted to do some real funky shape of some kind, then maybe, yeah, a bitmap would be the easier way to do that. You know, yeah, the other thing is, well, make it transparent. I'm not sure what you're asking. You can actually make these entire dialogues transparent, but not using the create dialog in Max. You'd have to use the form, a form in .NET and do this entirely in .NET, you could actually make it so these controls appear to just be floating on the screen above everything and see through of everything. You could even just leave this bar up top if you wanted. But generally, you can, you can actually make everything in a .NET form go completely transparent, which is kind of cool. I've done a bunch of that before. I'm not following you, Vincent, or in an other mesh that you use as a dummy with the shape you need. Getting back to my question of creating window using timers. On your website, you show, okay, Charles, go ahead with that one. I'll take a look at it. A form inside the viewport. Well, it should be on my website if that's what you're asking about. Are you talking about this one here? Or are you talking about, I don't know if I put another image in here. Is it my, the one with the teapot? Is it in this, on this window here somewhere? Oh, this one here. Yeah, this one's kind of neat. What you've actually got is a whole bunch of GDI plus drawing methods. And what I've done is I've created a .NET form, okay? And it is using the positions it's going and getting via Max script. You can go and get the position of every viewport. So what it actually gets is the position of the viewport and its width and height. And it creates a form that overlays directly on top of it. And the form has 100% transparency. So it's completely its background color has zero in the transparency for its color. And you can also turn off, again, check the form, check its properties, and you can actually go in and hide all of the title bar and everything like that. You can actually go in and hide all that stuff off and get rid of it, which means you can't close it directly anymore. You have to have some other way to manage that. And in this case, what I've done is I've hidden all that data off and then just simply overlaid it right on top of the viewport. And in real time, tracking the viewport, I'm basically drawing onto it the GDI plus drawing methods with a whole bunch of funky little algorithms I'm using. Like I'm creating little triangles. So I have a little function that creates a triangle and then rotates it into the correct place at the end points of the line. I've got the data being fed back and labeled over top. And essentially, each one of them is a little drawing. So you've got a line being drawn, a little triangle being drawn, being placed and found on the end of the line and rotated and pointed in the right direction because you can use transforms. I've got a box being drawn, and then I've got text being drawn on top of the box being laid in. And again, it's all being tracked. When you rotate this in the viewport, it all tracks with it and lays on top of it and orbits around with the scene. It's pretty cool the way it works. It was a fair bit of work, but not an enormous amount. This was all done for a client, actually, this tool, and I've never released it. But I'd like to release it at some point, which I can now. I've had okay to release it. But it did a bunch of things. It tracked the position and basically drew sort of linear position changes of the object, kind of like the trajectory, but it didn't do it between every single key. It didn't do it for every single frame. It did it for each key, so you could see its trajectory, linear trajectories and distances between keys, because that's what they needed. It gives you the size of objects. It did a few other things. Oh, velocity velocity and A would be, I forget now, velocity and, acceleration, I think it was, or something. It was for practical purposes. Actually, it was for, I can't really say what it was for, but it was for aerospace company. How's that? And the aerospace company needed to understand and know how to, they were building things and be able to pre-visit all. So they needed to know how something was accelerating and how fast it was accelerating so they could determine whether or not they were moving it too fast and how long it would take to move it from A to B, knowing that it could only reach a certain acceleration value and velocity along the way. So They needed this sort of information being fed back to them on objects as they were going. So, yeah, they were using Max for some pretty high-tech visualization purposes. So I wrote a whole host of tools for them that were feeding back data and allowing them to be able to control things in very sort of specific ways and manners, being able to animate things based on velocities and acceleration values and everything. So instead of guesswork sort of thing. So it was sort of rocket science. It was actually interesting working with this client because I have no idea what they were saying most of the time. And interestingly enough, they weren't allowed to tell me what they were doing either. So it was kind of like, it was strange. They'd have to say things like, so pretend we were doing something like this. How would you, it was really strange. Let's see. So let's get back to some of these other questions. Can we easily link other software like Photoshop with .NET? Or not at all? Good question. I've never tried. I don't know. I would assume there's probably ways of connecting it. I would assume there might be ways. You're most likely going to have to write Photoshop plugins and stuff if you want to go from Photoshop to Max. But if you want to go Max to Photoshop, that shouldn't be so bad because you can launch through shell launch and whatnot Photoshop. But sending constant commands to it, I think you'd have to write something on the Photoshop end. And I'm not sure. It's probably with C, I think. You'd have to be doing that. Getting back to my questions, I'm using Windows Timer. Yeah, Charles, we haven't answered your question here. So what was that link? Shoot, it doesn't actually produce a link. Let me actually go in and grab that. I think I've got it all. Creates a spline and handles for changing its shape. Works fine, but when I created a modifier with a button that opens, there's no spline being drawn in this window. Why is that? Was this one that I responded to eventually? Sounds familiar. Form. Oh, yeah, okay. This is this is one of the reasons what I've done. There's actually, I believe I know what he's doing here. Let's see if I can find specifics. .NET control button. I don't know what it's. It could be that is this guy's control actually in the modify panel? If it's in the mod, yeah, okay, that's why. So, unfortunately, the modify panel has this odd scope issue, and you run into it in a few things with Max Script as you're doing things, and one of them is .NET, unfortunately. And as you start writing stuff in .NET in the modify panel, you run into all kinds of scope problems trying to do things. Again, .NET runs in its own little scope, the event handlers, and you'll find that they simply don't work correctly or get. You know, you'll stop them from being garbage collected, but they still are. It's hard for them to get back into the modifier and sort of update the things properly. And you can use .NET directly, real simple. You need buttons and list views and stuff like that in the modify panel. That works fine. But as soon as you start getting funky with trying to run updates of all sorts and everything, it starts getting really difficult. I actually... back in with, let's see, where is it? One second. I actually have a link for it on my phone, and I'll show you a .NET UI running. Give me a sec, guys. Just remember where this is. Downloads, no, that's not it. Demo reel, temp demo reel. So it should be temp demo, oops, reel. Oops, how about I spell correctly? And so this is something I did for BioShock 2 when I was working on it. I don't know if it's playing way too fast for the update right now, but you'll actually see that what this is the modifier panel in a way. I actually stripped the rollouts. This is custom attribute definitions that have been that are in the modify panel when you open the modify panel, and then I actually am able to strip them out, and that's another thing in itself, out of the modify panel and dump them in here. But I ran into all kinds of problems doing this and getting this stuff to draw in. I got it to all to work in the end, but I had all kinds of issues trying to get this stuff to update correctly and work properly. It was quite an interesting feat to sort of make it work in the modify panel. And since I've learned that, just avoid the modify panel. It's even odd if you launch a rollout and you've got like a script on your drive and you file in it with a button in the modify panel and launch it, it's actually in some kind of crazy little scope again. This tool that you're asking, it will work with anything again. It's driving custom attribute definitions. And all I'm doing is wiring them. In this case, it is morph targets, and the morph targets are being wired up to the custom attributes. So that, again, it's nice and contained and not name dependent, or, you know, have these external hooks into things. It's just running known data. Now, what you're looking at is the earliest predecessor, sort of the earliest sort of version of my .NET facial UI system that I wrote. And it's a nightmare. It's all coded, like hand-coded, every single control, and it's the stupidest thing to do. But I didn't think it in advance about what to do. But what's nice about .NET is you can write one function, for instance, that creates one of these controls and creates the callbacks and everything else. And that one function will create one of these controls, and you can use it to generate all of them. And all you have to do is just simply put different tag data in each one so that each one knows what it's supposed to work with. In this case, I've written each and every single one of them in here one at a time with its own event handlers. It's, and this thing's like, you know, like if you look at the actual script going by on the side here, I don't know if you can see it scrolling by, but I could write it in about a tenth of the lines of code that's there now. I mean, literally, it's joystick light is much less code than this UI and can have infinite number of controls added to it, because it's based on sort of building it from specific functions and everything. So this was, I think this was a 2010 or a 2009 or a 2010 project. I don't remember now which one they were using when I did this. There's much cleaner ways I now obviously know to do things. So questions? Pose holder. So how do I do that pose holding that you saw in that and in the in my other tool? So the if I show where is it again? It is under /scripts/joystick. I think it's under here. I don't have a direct link to it yet. There it is. I've got all this pose holding that's going on here. Okay. So yeah, well, it's MacScript.net. It's in this case, in the one that you're seeing here, which is kind of a small image, you can click and drag on these items. Let me grab that and go back. Oh, there's the Swift. In this, the same thing, but I actually used, in here I used list view. No, this is a tree view in here, but it's the same basic idea. Each one of these is an item, is a .NET object that you can paint into. So you can use a paint event on each and every single one of these items. And when you see it go by, and I don't know if you can see when I scrub, see when I get further on, you'll see me scrubbing it. And I'll hit stop when I do that. There we go. You can see that I'm painting into it this funky gradient across that's tracking the mouse as I scrub my mouse on it. Well, I'm tracking the mouse. I'm using it like a slider, let's say. And when you click on it and drag your mouse, I can get the mouse position over it. And then I'm using the paint events to paint, in this case, a gradient into it. But I could actually, you know, in the case of the new one, the joystick light, I'm just painting a rectangle into it using the start point, so 0, 0. And the end point is wherever the mouse is, essentially. And I paint a red line across it so that it looks like you're dragging this sort of, you know, control across. And I'm just using the position the mouse is across it to get the value. And then kind of normalizing it because, you know, you want a slider that's 100 units wide, and these could be 200 units wide. So I just do the math just to sort of normalize that value down to 100 all the time. So this can change size, and it still does the same thing. But again, it's just using the paint event, and it's just tracking the mouse on it to get the position. So again, the way I've actually built this list, I kept messing around with it, and you'll see the top one up here. I don't know if you can see it. It looks like a list view, and it is. This one doesn't really look like a list view. You can override the painting of things like the top bar and in the list view and everything. You can make it paint and draw the way you want. I found it was a real pain to do, and what I found is easier is I made my own set of functions to build my own list view. This is a label container, basically, or flow layout panel. I stick a label in top and paint the text into it. Okay, so it's just a label on top. And then what I have is I have more labels. These are all labels, and they're just simply dropped in. And as they get dropped in, they get dropped in one below each other. And I run through the data that I'm using to build this list. I just run through the data and make labels and drop them in. And then each one of the labels, of course, all I have is a function for the header, a function for the group header, and a function for an item that creates an item. And again, all I store in it is in the tag data, I store information about that item. And every time an item's created, it fires off its own event handlers, it fires off its own instances of the paint events and whatnot. And so it's only three functions that draws as many of these as I want. And again, the way I store this data, sorry, I'm losing my voice here. One second. The way I'm storing that data is in an XML file back in a custom attribute definition. So I just create an XML file that stores the poses that are saved, the items that it needs to drive in those poses, the values of those poses, and it's all stored in an XML file. And as a string, stored right back into the file again. So as the animator creates the poses, it just stores that data into the XML. It reads and updates the XML file and writes it back to the string each time you add one. XML is fantastic for doing stuff like that. It's like a little sort of local database, you know, you can look at it as for tying information together and whatnot. Well, you can use a text file, but then you have to do all the string values yourself, and you have to do all the string parsing and everything the same yourself, and it's a pain. XML is fantastic because there's things like get element and get property and you're not having to go and try and find this stuff and do string parsing yourself. When you look at an XML file, again, let's go we'll go scripts. Tutorials.net. XML reading. So here's an XML file that's listed for you here. When you go and load it up using the XML reading and writing, which is all explained here, so I don't really need to get into how to do it completely. When you read this XML file and you get the root node, and the root node gives you this root node. If you check rootnode.children, you get that one and that one because they're children. Once you get this node, you can check its children, which are all these. You can ask it to go and get anything that's called preset, and it would return both of these. You can tell it to get anything that's called verts. It would return those. You can tell it to go and then get the data for each. So if we'd gone down to presets and collected an array of anything called presets, it's got a property called name. And you can see there's different names. We can then ask it for its verts, and we can get its property called data. It would return this string of data, which we'd then have to evaluate into whatever. So essentially, you don't have to go and start doing string parsing. You just tell it, go and get me this node, go and get me that node, go and get me the properties inside of this node. And you have to realize the properties are always returned as a string. So that's the only time that you need to start doing string parsing methods in MacScript. In this case, I've stored an array. But if you evaluate, so if I go in and get the root node, get the presets node, get the verts node, get the data property for the verts node, it'll return this and evaluate that. I'll have an array of 0.3 values. Fair enough? Go through my tutorials here and you'll be really sold. And you'll go, oh my God, this is the best way to actually store stuff. XPath? I think it does, or something like that. What did XPath do again? I've never used it, but I remember discussions about it, and I never bothered. What was XPath again? Just a group of tools for working with .NET, was it? Yeah, I think it does, or there's something out there. There's probably an add-on. Again, somebody's written a .NET, other group of tools for it. I've never bothered. I've just written my own group of functions for finding everything in MacScript, because that's the way I tend to be doing it. So yeah, just look around. You might be able to find stuff. A pop-up custom browser. Do you mean like a dialog box, like, like that? This is .NET, pretty much. Yeah, that's what you're looking at right there. That's MacScript is running this sort of stuff. And so if you can actually dig it apart in Max if you go find it. But yes, you can, sure. This is the form. .NET form. You can add menus. If you look up menus, forget the command for that, but you can create a toolbar, I think it's called. What was it called? Yeah, toolbars you look for, I think they're called. That'll be a toolbar. That'll be a toolbar. This will be a toolbar. And in toolbars, you can add items, and there are specific toolbar type object items that can be added. In this case, these added drop-down menus. And again, you can, I forget specifically what they're called in .NET. I always have to go look myself. Or you could actually use, one of the things I do often is I'll use Mac Script's RC menus for stuff like this when I need them to be just simple and don't need anything fancy. I'll just use the Mac Script RC menu fired off of a .NET button or a .NET click of some kind. So I'll do maybe a right click in here and have it pop up a menu. I just use the MacScript one if I needed something simple, because again, it's faster to write for and easier to write for. If I wanted to store stuff and tag properties and be able to color code these and have extra data and icons in them and all sorts and make them look real pretty, well, then you want to use .NET ones. So these are toolbars, toolbar buttons, and you can load up icons. And then this is just a tree view. And then tree view, you can do whatever you want with tree view. How is the selection stored in the main core body here? It's just when you open it, it reads whatever it is. I mean, again, if it was something that was updating when you clicked and changing like and this is one that's crazy. I've actually generated my own track view system in .NET MacScript. It was relatively slow, but it was for that same company. It was basically a mechanical animation tool system for dealing with mechanical animations. And it was pretty cool. Essentially, it looked like this. And this is tree view. And I was using callbacks to fire up callbacks for when things changed. And I was using, again, labels with rows of data and stuff and everything. It was kind of funny the way I did it. How is a selection stored in the main code body? I don't understand that. Selection in MacScript stores the selected objects. The keyword selection. Is that what you're asking? Yeah, the keyword selection stores a selection of objects. Objects stores an array of all of the objects in the scene. So you can you know, just when something changes, go through the selection. Selection, yeah, keyword selection is an array of selected objects. Select a bunch of things, type selection.count. It'll tell you how many objects are currently selected. So one of the issues can start becoming is speed. You know, MaxScript is not C#. Okay, so if you wanted to, you know, when I created this crazy UI, I could even find it for you, I'm sure. I wonder if I've still got it on my drive. Well, actually, you know where it is. You know where it is. It is right on the front page of this. There it is there, right there. So there's my own version of the track view dope sheet sort of thing. It's a crazy hybrid thing. What I would do is, MaxScript is not a compiled language. That's why it's slow. It's a runtime language. And, you know, again, it's not necessarily was designed to be, you don't compile MaxScript. It's compiled at runtime. No, and you can't compile MaxScript. It's just written, and then when you run it, it compiles at runtime, basically. And C# is going to be much faster. Now, if you wanted to make something real crazy and really good, and again, I should do this with my, and it's part of the reason why Joystick Lite is called Lite, is the next version of it, really what I should be doing is creating all of the controls and the UI and whatnot, and the main chunks of the UI in C#, calling it and putting it together in MaxScript, but basically all of the drawing methods and everything is happening internally in C#, and it would be much faster to run that way. So it would be much better. So unfortunately, there's no way, I think there kind of is, ask Marcel this one, if there's ways of writing plugins for Max with C#, there kind of is. But realistically, there's no direct way. You need C++. But what you can do is write UI items and tools and things that you can call on with MaxScript. The bottleneck always comes when you're converting MaxScript values to .NET values and back and forth. There has to be a conversion happening there, and it slows things down. So you kind of want to do as little in MaxScript in some cases as possible, and do it all, you know, do everything you can in .NET. So, you know, I mean, there's sort of plus and minuses to it all. If you wanted a truly, really, really fast, super fast tool running, you pretty much need to do it in C++, and have it running at the core, you know, using C++ to make it truly, really, really fast. But something like this tool here was 100% MaxScript .NET hybrid. It's a create dialog with a whole bunch of .NET stuff. This is actually MaxScript rollouts pulled out of custom attributes out of the modify panel. It's using toolbars and all sorts of stuff, all kinds of GDI plus drawing in it, and it was actually usable. It was slow. It wasn't super, completely fast, but it was completely usable for their purposes of tracking and animating objects in very mechanical ways. So I was pretty surprised at how well it worked. How's that? Now, I had to jump through hoops to make it fast. I had to do all kinds of sort of testing. Should I update? Shouldn't I update? You know, when can I defer an update on something until something else has happened? That sort of thing. But I managed to make it pretty quick. So it was pretty cool that it worked that way. Any more questions, guys? Looks like you're the only one left with me here, Charles. You're welcome. Sure, one more question, Charles. The facial bone class. The one that happened last week. Yep, the soundtrack. Yep, sorry, there's problems with it. Do you want me to record the sound over it at some point? Okay, will do. Okay, guys, well, thank you very much. We'll converse about that, Charles, via email is fine. And And glad you had another great session. So, quick question, how did it go? Do you think that was good? Did that work well for everybody? Was it too fast? Was it too slow? Would you suggest it to somebody else? Because again, I'm trying to make sure that these classes are really tailored and go over well to you guys. So feedback would be always welcome. My forum has got class space for the classes on it. So if you'd like to create yourself accounts or whatever, you can go in and post in the actual forums here for them. It'd be fantastic if you do that or give me feedback or whatever. If you sign up and want to be part of the Alpha Beta for the for Joystick Lite, I can add you in. You just add yourself to the group, and then I'll approve it, and you'll actually see another group in here for the Alpha Beta going on in there. Yeah, I know it needed to be probably a little too fast today, Matt. Again, I thought I was going to have to go a little quicker, but and is tough okay, Laurent? Is that, I mean, was it good tough? I mean, I tried to cover a lot, is what it, boiled down to. Yeah, I can upload the final script as well, actually, so you can see the whole final code, and you'll basically have the tool at that point. And I've completely commented, or most of it's been commented, I think, anyways, or some commenting in it. How's that? So to maybe give you a good idea what's going on. Certainly, ask questions on the. On the forum and on my forum here, and I can get you answers to things. Okay, guys, I am starved. I need some lunch in me now because it's now 1 o'clock in the afternoon my time. And thank you very much for coming out again and signing up. And I'm going to be posting the recording of this as soon as I can get it compiled. It takes quite a while to compile it and to upload it. And if I can again suggest to you that you keep it to yourselves, please, and not share it anywhere. I'm going, trying to make some money doing this, and I need to be able to continue to make a living. Again, I don't make DVDs anymore because of the piracy out there. There's just no point. About probably 10 to 1 piracy to bot, at least, if not more. I was actually shocked to hear that only one of my DVDs is ever sold in China, and zero in Russia. And that wasn't because of language. So, anyways, guys, take it easy, and we will hopefully see you at the next one.